Thank you for being here. I'm Jimmy Holmes, President and Publisher of the San Antonio Business Journal. On behalf of the Business Journal and the City of San Antonio, we welcome you to the San Antonio Air Quality Summit. We have a great lineup of speakers today. We'll be hearing from them over lunch. And just before 1 o'clock, we will have a group photo with Mayor Ron Nirenberg for businesses taking today's air quality pledge. More about that soon. First, the San Antonio Business Journal cannot bring you this program without the support of the City of San Antonio's Sustainability Department, especially Liza Meyer, who helped tremendously with our program. Liza, please stand so we can all recognize you. Well, representatives from the following event partners, please stand so we can say thanks and recognize you today for helping us create our first Business Journal Air Quality Summit. Via Metropolitan Transit. CPS Energy. Texas Aggregate and Concrete Association. And we also want to thank our association partners, Alamo Area Council of Governments, Yale San Antonio Green, Alamo Area Metropolitan Planning Organization, and San Antonio 2030 District. Please just thank all our partners for their attention. Before we get started with the program, I want to get personal for a minute. Some off the record kind of things. You know, when you run into someone who went to high school 20 to 30 plus years ago, and that person looks totally different now, shockingly though, it's in a good way. Plus, they're in fantastic shape. And you're not. And it kind of bothers you a little bit. You know, that guy that has that full head of hair, and you don't, and they look great, and you don't. I'm talking about myself. Well, let me tell you, from a mutual friend, I found out I went to high school with Ron Nirenberg. Yeah. So I was a year older, and I played just about every sport. 4 years of football. I was in great shape back then. I thought I was pretty big stuff back then. I was class vice president. Well, Ron Nirenberg, I found out, loved science back then, where he still does. Worked a bit on the school newspaper, and was in the band. And probably weighed 100 pounds soaking wet. I looked back and saw a picture. And Ron said to our editor, Tony and I recently, he was a little bit of a science nerd back then. And I didn't correct him, but, you know, yeah, no judgment. Well, since high school, things have really changed majorly. Big time for Ron and for myself. I think Ron has been working out every day since graduation. And I read about his protein shake routine in an Express News story months ago. As for me, I must confess, I've been out of the gym for a little bit. So now, I'm the nerd running the newspaper, and our extremely fit mayor, Ron Nirenberg, is the most popular guy and leading the greatest city in the tricentennial, celebration year and beyond. So let's give a hand for Ron Nirenberg. Now, I'm going to try to segue back to the reason why we're here today, which is a Business Journal Air Quality Summit. It isn't about Ron and my health and social standings. This issue is serious. I asked one of our special guest speakers this week, Rohit Sharma, why should San Antonio businesses and the community care about the EPA's designations of non-attainment ozone levels in San Antonio? And he said, are you kidding? Even if it is a marginal non-attainment designation, Rohit said the following. In a capped emissions environment, like a non-attainment area, you have to figure out how to reduce emissions in order to continue growing small and large businesses, as well as support the population growth of our area. With that being said, many of you may nevertheless be asking why the Business Journal is hosting an air quality summit. The truth is, the Business Journal shares the concern of many that not enough folks in our community in general, and in the business community particularly, fully appreciate the significance that our air quality has on so many levels, yet. I won't go into too deeply the significance, because that's what our distinguished speakers are here to do today. But I will briefly say that San Antonio will likely be challenged in the coming years to improve our air quality in years to come, and measured against federal standards that are expected to get tougher very soon. As you know, San Antonio is among the largest city in the United States, if not the largest, that's considered an attainment with respect to the previous standards. It's a designation that many don't know about, because being an attainment has meant that they haven't been inconvenienced in any way. I lived in Houston for 9 years. It affects every single day, every citizen, every your daily life. When you go to the gas pump, you know they're monitoring your emissions. And also, it's meant that the city has been able to grow as it sees fit, being an attainment city. And that will change in many ways that people have no idea right now about. Today's program, we think, will be enlightening in that regard, and we hope it will be a catalyst for action. Our presenters come at this issue from various perspectives, stemming from their organizations' missions and the role each of those organizations can and does play in improving our air. I would like to recognize a few San Antonio businesses here in the tent today who have started the movement of clearing the air for San Antonio. When I say your name, please stand and be recognized. Stephen Hennigan, CEO of Credit Human, added solar to Credit Human's headquarters in 11 branches that are also working on other many initiatives. Dick Tipp, CEO, Mission Park Funeral Chapels and Cemeteries, added solar to 7 locations and switched most of the company's fleet to electric vehicles. Guido Construction added solar to the company's headquarters, added 1 CNG power truck, 1 electric vehicle, and 8 CNG power forklifts. And I want to thank the San Antonio River Authority, has added solar to their wastewater treatment operations facility to serve as a cost-saving measure and educational tool. Regarding the River Authority, I want to add that I believe we need more low-impact development. We should continue to encourage incentives to build strong, modern, and sustainable buildings that are good for our environment, water sources, and recruitment of top talent and companies from other cities. Thank you all for helping clear the air. Thank you. Now moving on to today's presenters, VIA Metropolitan Transit. Unfortunately, Jeffrey Martin, CEO of VIA, was not able to attend today, but we will hear from Leroy Alloway, Director of Government and Community Relations for VIA Metropolitan Transit. We'll also hear from Rick Luna, Senior Manager, Energy Management, CPS Energy, Diane Rath, Executive Director of the Alamo Area Council of Governments, Dr. Rick Sashi, President of the Texas Aggregate and Concrete Association, and Rohit Sharma of Lino Basel in the 8-Hour Ozone State Implementation Plan Coalition. Before we get to our speakers, I want to introduce today's keynote. Just to reiterate, he and I go way back, although we didn't know it. I will spare you further high school stories about myself. Instead, I was just invited to sign my yearbook later, which I did bring. I was pretty cool about that. Long term out. But also, it just happens that at a time when our community around the country are having to deal more directly with the realities of living and non-attainment, San Antonio voters have elected a new mayor who cares very deeply about the issues and has promised to make it a priority in his administration. Mayor Ron Nuremberg has been part of the Alamo Area Council of Governments and has spoken frequently in public forums about the importance of doing more to get San Antonio cleaner air. He clearly sees this as a quality of life issue because it's a quality of health issue. It is our hope that our community will support him on this. So with that, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome my former classmate and mayor, Mayor Ron Nuremberg.
Good morning. Thank you, Tony, from all of my colleagues over at the Anderson High School, class of 95, Anderson Trojans. It is true, I was in the band for 4 years. I marched while Tony was playing. And I do have to say that at every single football game, Anderson won halftime.
I didn't say it was good.
Excuse me. Thank you all for being here. Clean air for me today means that I'm finally starting to breathe a little bit easier after suffering from all the allergies. And as I was driving, I apologize, I'm a few minutes late. It also means that there are some very practical solutions to clean air. One of them would be to get our driver's ed institutions to start teaching people how to merge on the highway at speed, normal speeds. Welcome, everyone. Today is an important day for all of us, and I come to you today not as a clean air expert, but as the mayor of San Antonio and as a dad. When I was first elected, my son, Jonah, asked me to take care of the bats. We had taken a trip out with my then colleague, Eloy, who's now over at Via. We had taken a staff trip out to the Bracken Bat Cave to see the majesty of this wonderful part of our landscape. And as you know back then, or as you may know back then, it was under threat of development, which would have threatened the colony as well as this very important water feature in our landscape. I worked in conjunction with public and private partners to ensure that the world's largest bat cave would be preserved in spite of the sprawl that our city was experiencing. Today, it's hailed as one of the most effective public and private partnerships in our state with regard to environmental sustainability. And the bats are safe too. Then Jonah asked me to take care of the trees and the water. Included in that is the commitment to clean air. Every mayor strives to build a healthy community, which is where the basics are done well. And overall, I'm responsible for making sure that San Antonio is a better place to live for all families, a place where businesses can thrive and where our residents can achieve success. And for those of you who have any of my Fiesta medals over the last few years, each one of them from year to year is a picture of what Jonah has asked me to promise to do. First year was the bats, the second year was a drop of water, the third year was the trees in the air, and it goes on from there. This event, which has established that we can harmoniously cultivate a healthy community and a vigorous economy, is a testament to the work that we've done to bridge the divide between business leaders and environmental advocates. And I see all of my friends from both sides of that equation here. It's a testament to our shared goal of creating a San Antonio that is resilient, one that does not need to divide communities, one in which it understands that when we come together for these difficult conversations, we create solutions, practical solutions. Because resilience isn't just about clean air and about water quality. It's about business practices that can endure and policies that effectively help us balance growth and sustainability. It's what you've been doing as smart business to evolve and prosper in an ever-changing world. I have with me today a letter from Governor Abbott to EPA Administrator Scott Pruitt, and it is dated September 27, 2017. It is a request from the governor urging Administrator Pruitt to consider delaying the designation of San Antonio. I came into this office with a set of core convictions that have continued to guide me as your mayor, and I believe we must never hesitate to act. So while Administrator Pruitt and Governor Abbott are deliberating and negotiating, I'm here to say San Antonio needs to continue to retain its title as the largest clean air city in the nation. Even in the midst of ambiguity, our course of action is very clear that we must attain clean air status. The medical science is unanimous. Poor air quality is a significant threat to human health. So regardless of the EPA's decision or lack thereof on how San Antonio is designated, we need to keep in mind that the primary focal point is the health of our residents, especially our children, your future employees. The charge to improve air quality is going to take some uncompromising decisions for each of us, and there are no quick fixes. This is among the biggest challenges facing our region that will present hurdles, as we know, for a flourishing economy. According to a recent study by the Alamo Area Councils of Governments, a federal clean air mandate could cost the San Antonio economy alone somewhere between $3.2 and $36.2 billion. That's a lot of money. We are better than that. A strong San Antonio economy was built and continues to prosper with the help of a business community that delivers the best ideas and the best products with unequivocal elements of risk and reinvention. You, in the business community, have been very well in displaying the essential spirit of innovation and practical problem solving that is needed to address our clean air solutions now more than ever. But we all need to agree to start on the premise that we all value the best of both, clean air and a healthy economy, and to take a new strategic outlook on the air that we all breathe. During this event, you will discover all the tools you need to be part of the solution. You will have an opportunity to publicly renew your commitment to air quality by completing the pledge cards which are located on your table. Some of the recommendations on the card will potentially challenge you to incentivize employee alternative transportation choices, such as busing or carpooling to work, while the other policies focus on fleets and energy conservation. City staff, and thank you all for the constant work that you do to guide us, is here and will recognize you and your pledge to clean air on the City of San Antonio's website. This event, as it should for all of us, really does give me hope. And I know there are a lot of people watching us in this room, because the premise that we can clean our air is not one that moves forward unless we're all in the room together. And for the first time in our city's history, with regard to our intervention into clean air strategies, we're finally all in the same room. You have my gratitude for the efforts and your assurance as stewards of our great community. And I look forward to working with you and other members of our business community on this very important topic. So I do want to thank you all for being here today as a testament to your interest in building a San Antonio that is resilient, that is sustainable, and that is forward-thinking. Our commitment to clean air does not come at the cost of a strong economy, but is fortified by the work that each of you do to ensure that we leave a better San Antonio for our kids. And at the end of the day, isn't that what we're all trying to do, whether we're in business or civic life or in nonprofit or in activism? We're simply trying to make sure that the San Antonio we leave our children is better than the one that we inherited ourselves. And I can't think of a better way to underscore that message in the midst of a community that's going to be growing by leaps and bounds, that will expect another 1.5 million people to be living among us in the next 3 decades, that we hold our ground on clean air. And we know, as you do, that the choices are going to be tough. But the important point in all this is people argue back, well, there's no federal mandate, there's no federal backstop. Remind them that the medical professionals in the room must be uncompromising about your children's health. Remind us also that where we have already set the federal standards is not where we need to be. We need to be better than that. So regardless of where that standard ends up being with regard to a designation, we need to be shooting for better than we are today, and that will continue as the process unfolds. I know that we have the same goals to ensure that San Antonio we pass on to our kids is better than the ones we found it, cleaner, more efficient, and intensely focused on providing opportunity for all of our residents. When I think of Jonah, I think of the world that he will inherit. Join me today in ensuring that his future and the future of your children is one where they won't have to worry about federal sanctions. San Antonio is a leader in clean air, and that commitment starts today with each and every one of us. And one final note about clean air and health and opportunity for all of our residents. We've had a lot of conversations about this notion of equity. Health is equity. When we provide for clean air for our children, we are providing for an equitable community. When we make sure that it doesn't matter whether you live in San Antonio or in Boston or in Mexico or wherever else, we all are working together to ensure cleaner air for our own communities, but also for the world that we share. That's equity. I want San Antonio to be a partner in that, and I know you do too. So thank you for your time, your commitment, your hope. Together we will build a San Antonio that is indeed prepared for its future. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mayor. We appreciate you being here, and we look forward to working with you to help engage San Antonio's business community on your side. We're not going to take a break for lunch. We're going to keep going. We've got a lot of great content to share with you. So I hope you're enjoying your lunch. Our first presenter is Leroy Allen, Director of Government and Community Relations for BIA Metropolitan Planning. VIA has injected a distinct environmentally conscious aspect into the organization's overall mission, which rides on top of the inherent environmental benefits of having a robust, widely used public transportation system. Everyone, the floor is yours.
Well, it's always challenging to speak for a group, especially following the mayor, so hopefully you'll bear with me for the next few minutes when we talk about some of the activities that VIA is undertaking. If we can pull up that presentation, that would be a great help. While that's loading, I do want to point out to everyone, on your places is a pamphlet for VIA Works. This is our employee-employer commuter benefit program. We have over 100 businesses participating today with over 10,000 employees making transit part of their daily commute. We've got staff here that can help answer any questions you may have about how we can incorporate VIA Works into your company and how we can partner with you to bring transit as an option for your employees to save their time, save them some headaches in the morning with the commute, and most of all, help clean the air. Because when we are putting people into transit, we are taking roads off the vehicles off the road, we are able to have a positive environmental impact. I see the presentation is up, so we're going to go ahead and jump on in. Forgive the Game of Thrones reference. I think this is what we're all expecting every morning. At least I know this is what I deal with. Winter is coming. We have 1 million residents coming to the San Antonio region by 2040. Or put it another way, the city of Austin is coming and they're bringing all their cars. And if you really want to see what winter looks like, we can go up I-10 a little bit and look at the Katy Freeway in Houston. This was a $2+ billion roadway reconstruction project. Expanded the roadway, 23 lanes across at its widest sections, including HOV lanes, which we love. They are providing a way to move people, not just cars. But it's also an example of how latent demand starts influencing and impacting our transportation system. Today, well, I would actually be on the right slide. Well, we skipped it. Today, it takes longer to go from downtown into Katy, from Katy into downtown Houston than it did before the $2 billion construction project. In the morning, it's almost 30% more. In the afternoon, it's almost a 40% increase in your commute. So the concept that bigger is always better may not necessarily apply when it comes to transportation. We need to look at ways to move things smarter instead of simply adding more lanes and putting more asphalt, more concrete on the ground. But we do know the future is bright. We do know there are options and opportunities ahead of us as a community to make a lasting positive impact upon not only this generation, but the generations to come. Mayor, we can give Jonah an opportunity to have mass transit beyond just rubber tires on the road. And that's what we're focusing on at VIA on a daily basis. Our board last year adopted our 2040 vision. It's three planks: building a better bus network, investing and building in rapid transit, and integrating technology into smart transit to help advance the community. On the building a better bus system, we're already making progress on that today. With the leadership of Mayor Nuremberg and members of the San Antonio City Council, this fiscal year, for the first time, the city of San Antonio is investing $4.3 million into VIA to increase frequency on 9 routes and 9 key corridors. And that really deserves a round of applause for the visionary work they're doing. And this is our vision for 2040. We want to guarantee that even in peak morning, evening rush hour, you have a bus coming every 20 minutes. Today, there's one line in the VIA system that has service better than 20 minutes, and that's Primo on Fredericksburg Road. One line out of 92 routes that we serve. We want to look at later hours of service. We recognize our community works 24/7, we do as an agency, but we need to have vehicles on the road later to provide that option for workers who may be coming off at 11 o'clock, at 12 o'clock at night. We're going to be expanding Primo. We actually have 2 new Primo routes under construction right now on Zarzamora and Military. We're looking at how we can double the fleet size and also find easier ways to pay fares so we can get people on board quicker and have less waiting at the light, at the stops, for people dealing with cash to be able to board. And while we're working on these 2040 plans, we're also working on ways we can accelerate the smart growth today. What you're seeing on the screen now are just some of the projects that VIA has been investing in. From Central Plaza at Via Via, which will have 1.1 million passengers this year come through that plaza, to the installation of 1,000 new shelters. Let me put that in perspective. From 1978 through 2013, VIA installed 1,300 shelters in our service area. In the last 3 years, we've added 1,000 to that. When our 1,000th shelter goes in later this year, 95% of the boardings that happen in the VIA system will happen at a stop with shade and a shelter. That is an unheard of number in a system this size. And if you look nationally, we actually know of transit properties that are taking shelters away from the community because they don't want to pay for their maintenance. We're making that investment to give our customers and our passengers an amenity throughout the region. We're building a new parking structure at Stone Oak at 281. It'll be open at the end of this year. 400-space garage that will also see an express route coming from Stone Oak and an express route going across town into the South Texas Medical Center. So it's a different type of service that we're glad to provide. We've also invested in more environmentally friendly vehicles. You may have seen them on the road lately. They're the new vehicles that are red, gray, white. We like to say they're red on the outside and green on the inside. This is our compressed natural gas fleet. 97% less NOx emitted than the diesel vehicles they replaced. We have 270 of those vehicles on the road today. And because of this investment, VIA is home to the largest CNG fueling station in North America. We have made a commitment to environmental quality that extends throughout our entire fleet. I want to discuss the projects on the bottom. Let's jump into the rapid transit network, because I know this is where you start getting a lot more attention. We're looking at ways to bring bus rapid transit in a dedicated right-of-way and or possibly light rail transit to this community. It's not going to be an easy discussion. There will be a lot of emotional conversations we have to have over the coming months and years as we work through this. But this is the right time to start having this discussion. This is the right time to start putting forward a plan to bring the next generation of multimodal transportation options to a community that is growing by leaps and bounds. And so that's what we've been doing, working on these four corridors, going from downtown up to the Stone Oak area by the airport, going up to the UTSA area and the medical center on the northwest, looking east-west from AT&T Center over to the Pelley-Lackland area, and looking from Brook City Basin to downtown. These four corridors have a high potential for providing that transformative transit project that we know the community is wanting and the community is asking for. But we will not abandon having that fundamental better bus system underlying all that we do. It's not an either or choice for us. It's an all of the above. And finally, we're looking at smart transit. What do we mean by smart transit? Well, 10 years ago, who would have known that we would have had the iPhones and Androids in the palm of our hand? We don't know what 10 years from now will look like, but we know today we're working with our mobile developers to make sure we've got great mobile apps. If you haven't downloaded it yet, VIA Go Mobile, buy your fare online, do your trip planning. I see the stop sign, some are almost done.
No problem.
And it's also our commitment that we're going to look at ways to integrate technology as we move forward. As innovation keeps happening, transit has to change as well, and we're glad to do that. This is what our vision looks like. 41 routes with vehicles arriving every 15 minutes, 7 corridors of either bus rapid transit in its own lane or light rail transit, a $7 billion capital cost. We are talking significant dollars in investment needed to make this vision a reality. But this is what keeps our 2,000 employees focused every day, providing that opportunity and the public service in providing transit. what I wanted to leave you with is this. The image with the kind of sad two lines is our high-frequency network today. Those are the lines that provide 10 to 12 minute frequency across San Antonio and South Texas. If you look at our 2040 plan, you see a more robust network. You see a network that's designed for transit to work for everyone. Or if you put it another way, this is the DNA of our system. Where you see the green is transit that we know, based on research, if you have a car, that type of transit will be attractive to you, 10 to 12 minute frequency. You can see the small amount we have today. It is expanding thanks to the City of San Antonio's investment, and we appreciate that. But 2040 is where we're still aiming. We're looking for that transformative system so transit becomes a choice and not simply an occasional option for you. Thank you for your time this morning, and again, we have staff standing by outside to talk with you about VIA Works. We'd love to be able to expand our numbers and add more of your employers and employees to the transit family. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Leroy. Who agrees that riding the bus is mass transit? So, if we don't ride the bus and we don't increase that frequency line, I'm all for rail, I'm all for investing in the future, but the best way to show the demand is to ride the bus and create demand so we can start investing in the future. Our next presenter is Rick Boone, Senior Manager, Energy Manager at CPS Energy. San Antonio is fortunate to have a municipality-owned utility that has been among the leaders in its industry and it's among when it comes to taking steps to reduce its carbon footprint. And Rick is key part of the management team. Ladies and gentlemen, Rick Boone.
Thank you.
Thank you for that, and thank you for the opportunity to represent CPS Energy here today. So I'm here continuing the theme of solutions and things that we can all do to help improve air quality, and in my case, we're going to be talking about that through the lens of energy efficiency, solar, renewable energy, electric vehicles, and other such solutions. So let me start by talking a little bit about how we're able to do these things in San Antonio. A few years back, our city council had the vision to approve the Safer Tomorrow Energy Plan, which really, in a significant way, opened up the opportunities to promote and encourage customers, whether homes or businesses, to save energy and really unleash a whole array of programs that customers could engage with. Today, we offer over 20 different solutions that customers can adopt to help them save energy in a significant way. Why is that important for the theme today? Reduced energy use has a direct correlation to improved air quality. We have accountability procedures for our STEP program. Part of what we report back every year is the reduced emissions from the energy efficiency. And so I have a table up here that indicates the amounts of significant amounts of pollutants that are avoided through the STEP energy efficiency program. And so, as I said, really, STEP unleashed the opportunity for customers to engage in energy efficiency in a significant way, and we're seeing that customers are really embracing it in large numbers. So, for example, today we have 10,000 customers who have adopted solar, which is a huge number, and I'll show you a graph in a minute that shows you just the absolute escalation in the last couple of years in the number of people who are looking at solar. Connected devices, thermostats, have become a very much a popular item for consumers. And so we run a series of programs where customers can connect those thermostats to the CPS network, and we have the ability to reduce energy on peak days, which makes a significant contribution to the reducing peak on the hottest days of the year. We've weatherized 17,000 homes and continue to do this work every day, helping low-income customers through improvements up to their home and improvements that help them save energy and reduce their bill. And finally, our large commercial customers have really stepped up. We have over 400 large businesses who on a given day in the summer are available to reduce energy demand. And so if you've been to a Target, if you've been to a Walmart, a number of
hotels, large commercial customers who are available and ready to reduce demand at our request. And so there's a wide range of programs that are available to customers. One of the things that is really the bedrocks of our efforts is to have a solution for every customer. Whether you are interested in saving energy through improvements to your building, whether you are interested in solar, whether you're interested in electric vehicles, we have a charging network that our customers can hook onto. We have multiple thermostat options, and as I mentioned earlier, we have weatherization. So we try to cover the entire range of solutions that customers are looking for. And we introduce new programs every year. This year we rolled out a new cool roof program to encourage customers to use energy efficient roof materials in their home. And we're continuing to look at other opportunities to continue to grow energy efficiency in our community. And so the STEP program has this goal of 771 megawatts of reduced capacity by 2020. I'll tell you that we're about 70% of the way there, but we still have the other 30% to go, and that's where we need your help. Is to step up and adopt some of these solutions. And so I'll start with, we have three quick ideas for you. The first one is we have an array of low and no cost programs that are available to you. So if, for example, you had to change the LED light bulbs in your home, we have retail buy-down programs at Costco, Walmart, Sam's. We have connected thermostat programs that we run. Coming up on Black Friday, we'll have a $150 rebate that customers can take if you want to purchase a Nest thermostat or an Ecobee thermostat. There's 20 different options that you can purchase. If you connect to the CPS network, we'll give you a $150 rebate. Pay down a significant part of the cost of that. If you're a small business person, we have tune-up programs now that will help you to save energy and improve the performance of your unit without having to make the replacement, right? So in a lot of cases, the units, you know, they may have 10 years of useful life, but they can still use a tune-up that would help save energy for your business. So give us a call if you're interested in that approach. Earlier, someone mentioned solar and all of the businesses that have adopted solar. We have a solar rebate program. We have other solar programs that help customers be able to adopt solar. There are 55 companies in San Antonio now that can install a system for your house and or your business. And so we encourage you to explore solar if you haven't already done so. You'll see there the graph that shows just the amount of capacity that has been added to our system for solar customers. We're now up to 80 megawatts, which is a significant amount. Last thing, and I'll end with this solution, is our Reduce My Use program. Hopefully you've seen these messages. We're now messaging broadly to customers on the hottest day of the year to encourage them to reduce energy. And then we're following up with a message that tells you how you did relative to your neighbors. And the idea here is we want to really drive broad engagement with energy use, really make you aware of tips and things that you can do to reduce energy on those hottest days. And so with that, I'll end by asking you to please go to our website or give us a call at 353-2-SAVE. We're there to help you find solutions and help you, again, improve air quality, save some money, and improve the operation of your home and business. So thank you very much.
The agency that handles the actual monitoring for air quality. With that, I turn the microphone over to Diane.
Good morning. And thank you for having me. I'm excited to be here, but I have to tell you, you are a wonderful audience, but it's really, really hard to see speaker after speaker after speaker, particularly when you can't move, and we're really stuck in this place. And they told me I couldn't move. So I'm sorry, thank you all very much for your patience. I want to tell you a little bit, about ACOG, because most people have a clue who we are. We are a political subdivision of the state. We cover all 13 counties, going up to Gillespie County, going down to McMullen County. So we have most of the Eagle Ford in our area, and very different demographics to the north. And we have 11 major programs, everything that you can't do within the set borders, as all of our colleagues do within the state of Texas and throughout the country. There's some coverage in almost every place. Today we're talking about one of our most important ones for this region is air quality. And one thing I want to mention, because we talk a lot in San Antonio, we're going to have a million more people by, you know, in the next 20, 30 years. We talk about Bear County and million, 2 million more. We have New Braunfels, which is the fastest growing city percentage-wise in the country this year. But let's look at the region. Let's really start north of Austin. Let's start with Round Rock. Let's start with the northern counties. Let's go all the way our southern border past Frio. And let's go to the east and go to the west. Go out to Gillespie. Go all the way over to McMullen. You're talking about 7 million people coming to this region. That's what we need to focus on. We need to focus on the air and the transportation and all the issues that are going to be impacted by 7 million people. And we talk about we have the air, we have our designation, we have all this stuff. Why? Okay, the people in this room are very knowledgeable. There's a lot of people that really don't understand federal law many decades ago, Clean Air Act, that really dictates for health. The whole reason is for health. And so they set the parameters for 6 different pollutants. The one that matters to us is ozone. And very importantly, they're prohibited by statute from taking into account the cost of what they're recommending. And I thank the mayor for referencing it. We have had some challenges this year, because for 20 years, the cities in the state that were in near non-attainment, San Antonio is the largest city in the entire country that is in attainment. That's the only reason we have Toyota here in San Antonio. They wouldn't have come here had we not been in non-attainment. They didn't go to Dallas for that specific reason. It had a very real cost when you go into non-attainment. We are the largest reason, and I always have to thank our partners. I'm very, very grateful to the city, to their county, thank you all, and to CPS Energy for stepping forward and filling that funding gap when the governor vetoed the funds, saying that it was a local responsibility. So our public partners stepped up, and very importantly, our private partners stepped up, because that's what it takes. It takes public and private working together to have a solution. So I really and truly have to express our deep appreciation to STEER, who is here, to CPS, to TACA, who is here, to our four cement countries. They demonstrate how important air quality is to all of us by filling that funding gap. Now let's talk about it a little bit. So in our area, 68% of our ozone comes from outside the region, 32% comes from inside. What's very important about that is that we can only impact 32%. But critically, it's within our power to do it. And we are doing it through voluntary compliance. Over since the mid-90s, we have brought our ozone levels significantly down. So the fact that 68% comes outside does not mean that we can't do anything. In fact, all we have to do is lower our ozone levels 5% more. And we are home free. We can do it, we can get there, the steps are in place. And very importantly, thanks to the efforts that CPS is making, the significant efforts that VIA is making, you all don't understand what they are doing to this region to drive it down. With the changes in cars, we are going to make very good progress, but only if we partner together to continue the efforts and the improvement we've made. Mayor, I have to thank you. With your leadership, we're continuing the efforts that really started under then-Mayor Wolf, then-Councilman Lyle Larson, and a county commissioner from Comal to really bring the region together to set in place those voluntary measures that have allowed us to go from 90 parts per billion down to 72 and 73 parts per billion. And the solution is the voluntary continuing partnership, collaboration, commitment, education, and bringing both public and private sector together, because all of us will pay the price if we don't. So when we look at where ozone comes from, every one of us, as you have heard, can impact it. Used to be the problem with cars on the road. The technology has gotten so much better that no longer is it cars, it really is point source. It means a single place. So the contribution that CPS has made by closing the DD plant early has a huge impact on all of our air. The contribution that our cement plant are making has a tremendous difference. Every penny that they invest in technology helps all of our health and helps this area. Every penny that oil companies have invested in Eagle Ford continues to improve that. So all of our larger businesses, what Toyota, what manufacturers are doing, that's a huge improvement. The rest is up to us on a voluntary measure that we have to take, and we've done that. Just has come from over 2012 when we started our voluntary collaboration with EPA, and we've gone all the way down to 72, 73 through voluntary efforts. Remember, we were in the 90s, in the middle 90s, so we're now down to 72, 73. And what's important is that it's not all Bexar County. One of our monitors is in full compliance with a lot of room to spare. We have two that are slightly over. Slowly over than cut. We don't get to rest on our laurels. We have to continue driving. We have to continue our effort so that we don't have to worry about it because the economic cost is too much. Yes, Houston has made improvements. You bet. They've been in moderate since the very beginning. They spent billions on it. When you visit Houston, have you ever wondered why your gas costs more? Jimmy and I were talking about it before you started, 20, 30 cents a gallon. Can't pump your gas until the sea was right. You go for your car inspection, you're going to pay $30, $40 or more just for your car inspection. So there's a very real cost if we don't continue to make improvement and we don't continue to drive it down. As long as we demonstrate the improvement, we are making very good strides. And as we've gone over and reviewed the changes that we've been making, we're on the right path. We have to continue it. Otherwise, we will have a problem with even worse congestion, because the worst consequence, even marginal, is that our roads will be more congested because of non-attainment designation. Having to truly have everything take at least a year longer to go through an approval process. And every single level of non-attainment takes longer. So we appreciate what you're doing. The costs, as the mayor referenced, at marginal, up to $1 billion a year for our region. And it's a real cost, it's lost jobs, it's individual costs that will be impacted. And that's without what industry has to do. And why do we do this? We do it for our health. So the mayor referenced the governor's letter, trying to have EPA take into consideration what's special about our region and note the significant improvement we've made so that we're allowed to continue doing our voluntary measures with public and private partnerships and not have the burden and the forced measures from outside. So I appreciate it. It's a lot of information. I thank you, but we need to continue the partnership. Thank you, Mayor, for the city's leadership, because that will continue to drive it down so we really don't have to worry about it anymore. Thank you.
Thank you, Diane. Our next presenter is Dr. Rich Sheezy. I've talked to him several times prior to this. Sexy? That's why I have an editor telling you. He's the president of the Texas Aggregate and Concrete Association, the industry that Rich represents by its very nature, very intentional when it comes to contributing to the concentration of air particles that we measure for with respect to federal air quality standards. At the same time, his association is active in trying to be part of the solution. And I'll let him tell you that. Rich, take a look.
It's always nice when I get called back and somebody wants to bring sexy back to the stage, so I certainly appreciate that. I'm here to kind of address some of the growth issues. I think we've had several speakers, key speakers, talk about the demand and the size that we are growing to. And the three things I can absolutely guarantee for you, debt, taxes, and material consumption tracks in a linear fashion with population. I've got to come up with a cool one word for that, like debt and taxes. The one thing that demand absolutely tells us in this room is that our industry, in the San Antonio major metropolitan area, we have 37 aggregate facilities. We have over 80 ready-mix plants, and we have 4 cement mills. Every one of those facilities is critical and vital to supporting the growth you just heard about. every one of you got here today through our industry, whether it was the home you live in or the road you transit, you were able to drive on to get here. But our facilities are often associated with emissions, which we do have. Most of those emissions are particulate. They're governed by a variety of state and federal agencies, and I'll give you two other key statistics for you. We are governed, and many of your facilities are governed, by the largest environmental regulatory body in the world, as the EPA. The second largest regulatory body in the world is the TCEQ, and our facilities are governed by both of those permits. And in fact, many of the particulate matter that you are associated with our facilities, an aggregate facility or a concrete facility, those are the same particulate matter that you find on unpaved roads or unpaved parking lots and are generally settled in on the property. And our cement mills, while they are point sources of emissions, are not major contributors to some of the emission counts that you've seen on some of the graphs. But that doesn't stop us from being partners with ACOB and supporting those initiatives. That doesn't stop us from voluntarily investing in technology to improve or reduce our emissions. That certainly doesn't stop us from compliance with permits. And that's the other last thing I want to leave you with. The permits that facilities and industrial facilities have to operate on to support growth, compliance with permits is environmental stewardism, because they are both protective of the communities in which they operate and still support growth. And that is the one key thing I want to leave you with, is the importance of compliance with permits, established permit protocols, and reliance on those permits to protect the health and welfare of a community, particularly one that's growing in the size and shape we are in. And I'll leave you with one last thing that I always like to tell people about statistics. Because you saw that about 1.5 million people by 2040, and for the UT grads in the room, that's only 23 years. As an A&M grad, I get to take that shot every time. In 23 years, 1.5 million people, if you take the major metropolitan statistical area population here, and let's call it 3 million, and we're going to add 1.5 million in that time, that gives us 23 years to build half of San Antonio that took us, thankfully, 300 years to get to. We have 23 years to increase the size of San Antonio by 50% to accommodate that growth. These are staggering numbers, and part of that is the partnership that's going to exist between all of us here to understand health, welfare, and community standards must be maintained by those of us on the industrial side, those of us on the regulatory side, and the community members in which we serve. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for allowing me to come in and talk about it.
Presenter is Rohit Sharma of Find Out Lady. We've saved him for last because he's a particularly relevant story to tell us. Rohit has been an integral part of the Houston region's efforts to reduce its air pollution. It's a city and region that has lived with the consequences of being a non-human city. So his message is one we all need to listen to. And he goes by Roh. I found out. I asked him, you go by Rohit? Because someone from Valero said, oh, I know Roh. So I asked him, you go by Rohit? And he said, my mom and you call me Rohit. My friends call me Roh. I said, are we not friends? He said, yeah. And then they know him really well. He's got a great presentation, very passionate about this honor issue. So please welcome Rohit.
Thank you, Jimmy. As Jimmy said, I go by Roh Sharma. I work for a company called LyondellBasell. LyondellBasell is a chemical manufacturing facility. We have 12 facilities in Texas. We have more in Ohio, Illinois, and we have a bunch of facilities in Europe and in Asia. But what I'm really here to talk to you about is the Houston experience, and that's why I was invited here. We've been doing this for, in Houston, I've been doing it for Houston 20 years. We've been doing it in Houston for 30 years altogether. And some of the lessons learned, I think, are important to share with other folks. I'm going to try to share that with you today. The one thing you're going to hear me say a couple of times today, and I think it's really, really important. It's already been alluded to with some of the presentations before me. You can have both. You can have air quality, and you can have economic growth. It is possible. I think we are accomplishing that in Houston. And I'm always surprised by folks that think it's one or the other, and you cannot have both. And I think we've heard a little bit of this from the mayor today, is you can have both, and it's been proven. And hopefully you'll agree with me by the end of the presentation that it can happen. So what I'm going to talk to you about is, I'm going to show you a little bit of the, and you saw some of this from the San Antonio area. So I'm going to show you this from the Houston area. I'll set up some of the points that I'm going to make. So we'll talk about the trends. We'll talk about the Houston area emissions, very similar to San Antonio, and a pie chart that you saw from Diane. I'll show you one for Houston. I'm going to show you how this was accomplished over the last 25 years. Talk to you about the business group that I belong to in Houston that's done a lot of this work. And I'll summarize and do some takeaway points for you guys. Okay, lots of numbers. Don't get lost in the numbers. Lots of acronyms, all of that. Don't really need to concentrate on any of that. Take a look, generally speaking, at the trends here. What you're seeing here is the days in Houston when the area monitors indicate exceedance of the air quality standard. So this is measuring the number of days that you've exceeded the air quality standard. And what you have here is, if you take a look at the left side, this is not a 4 or 5 year trend. This is 1999 to the left side of this chart. Okay, so you're talking about 17 years here that I'm tracking. And if you just look at the general trend, it doesn't matter what standards you're talking about. And by the way, there are multiple ozone standards. So when you talk ozone, you got to kind of think about which standard you're going to talk about. There's the 1979, a 1 hour, 120 part per billion standard. There's the 1997, 8 hour, 84 part per billion standard. It's the 2008, 75 ppb standard. And now we have the new 2015, 70 part per billion standard. The reason I mention all that, this is a moving target. Those targets are continually moved downward. So when you meet a standard, or just when you think you've met a standard, the target moves down, and it's continually moving down. This is a moving target by the EPA. That's the reason I mentioned that. So once again, look at these trends in Houston, starting from 1999. I think this is a pretty tremendous improvement here. And oh, by the way, we have 52 monitors in and around Houston. We started with around 10, went to 19, went to 25, and now we have 52 area monitors in and around Houston. It is the most monitored city, not in the United States, in the world. We have the highest amount of air quality monitors. These are monitors that actually measure the air, right? So this is not modeling, this is not funny math. This is actual measurement of air quality. That's what these monitors are measuring. So that's what this data comes from. Okay, a little bit more specific. Let me break this down. These are NOx concentrations, nitrogen oxide concentrations. What's NOx? Where does it come from? NOx comes from essentially anything that burns puts off NOx. So combustion engine from cars, diesel engines, barbecue places, fireplaces, my industry, the chemical industry, we have boilers, furnaces, anything that burns puts off NOx. Okay? This is a measurement of NOx, and NOx contributes to ozone formation. So this is, again, a general trend of the NOx concentrations, and this is 30 years of data. So the left side of this is 1986. It's tracking. Okay? So we've got a 66 reduction in NOx emissions, a reduction in NOx emissions over 30 years in Houston. HRVOC, I told you there will be a lot of acronyms here. It'll get tested afterwards. This is highly reactive VOCs. Now, this is an interesting story, and this is the reason why I want to show you this chart. So highly reactive VOCs, this chart starts in 2006. Well, why in 2006? This rule was put into place in Houston in 2005 and 2006. A tremendous amount of science was done by the state, by TCEQ, and by our industry. And guess what it pointed to? It pointed to HRVOC type of emissions. And these are, let's get down here, you probably can't see them, but these are propylene, ethylene, butenes, butadiene. Okay? These come from car engines, but they also come from industry. So we pointed at ourselves. So when this rule was put in place, the science led us here. And so we pointed to ourselves. So we put regulations and controls in place in Houston in 2005, 2006, and there has been about a 56% reduction in emissions since then.
Okay, next pollutant. This is, again, acronyms, ETEX, E-T-E-X. It's a component of VOCs. In fact, Diane talks about this, the volatile organic compounds. But this is benzene, toluene, ethylbenzene, xylenes. Well, where are those found? Again, in gasoline. You can find them in gasoline that burn in cars, but also produced by the chemical industry. So let's look at BTEX. And this is 30 years of data also. And you have about an 83% reduction in BTEX. This is a really, really good story here. 83% reductions in 30 years. All right, where am I going with all this? Here's a chart that summarizes what I just showed, the last three or four slides that I showed you. And I think this is a very, very interesting slide. So you've got the 1 hour design value here at the top. And you got the 8 hour design value here at the top. In the background here, notice in gray, population growth in Houston. Okay, so we are at 6.5, this is not just Houston, but the surrounding area of Houston, the non-attainment area is 8 counties in and around Houston. So you got 6.5 million people now. Okay, we've come from about 4 in 1991 when this was being tracked. Okay, so with that population growth, and there's one bar that they took off this chart I wish they would not have, which is GDP, economic growth. And that economic growth mirrors this population growth here. So with population growth come cars, right? Car growth, population growth, GDP growth, all up. But at the same time, your ozone emissions are down. There were plenty of people in Houston that said, no way, no way Houston would ever meet any of the ozone standards. They said that for 120 part per billion standard, we met it. They said that for the 84 part per billion standard, we need it. They are now saying that with the 75 part per billion standard, we're at 78 ppb. We're marching towards 75 ppb. It can be done. Back to my point that I made earlier. You can't have economic growth and you can't have air quality. These standards can be met. Okay? It takes a work. It takes a lot of work to do that. And I'll talk about that a little bit. All right, next slide. This is a really interesting slide. A lot of stuff on here, but let me point out the important stuff here. And we saw some of this for San Antonio from Diane earlier. So the chart at the top of that. This slide kind of shows you how ozone is made, okay? So you've got to have sunshine in order to make ozone. On the left side here, you've got to have stagnant conditions, because if you have windy conditions, you don't make ozone. It has to be stagnant. You have to have oxygen. Well, we've got oxygen all around us. And then at the bottom part of the chart are emissions, okay? So that's the recipe to make ozone. Any one of those is not there, you don't make ozone. So on a cloudy day, you usually probably don't make ozone. On a windy day, you don't make ozone. Oxygen, there's nothing you can do about that. Out of this chart, the only thing that we can control, really, is the bottom part of this, which is emissions, right? Can't control the sun, can't control the wind, can't control the oxygen. So you control the emissions. So take a look at the bottom part of the chart, and this is for the Houston surrounding area. So the left side of this pie chart will tell you the VOC emissions, the volatile organic compound emissions. This is stuff that evaporates. This is paints and thinners and gasoline, anything that evaporates, VOCs. If you look at that chart, if you look at the red here, that's area sources. What are area sources? 61% in Houston of VOC emissions come from area sources. Small businesses. This is dry cleaners, machine shops. Okay, 61%. Mobile sources, cars, trucks, 23%. And then point sources, that's my industry, large manufacturing. Right, 16%. Switch over to the NOx side. Remember I said NOx, anything that burns puts off NOx. Okay, NOx emissions, 67% come from mobile sources in Houston. Point sources, my industry again, is 26%. And then area sources, these are small businesses, 7%. So that's the emissions profile in Houston. Very important to know your emissions profile in your area. Okay, that helps you kind of plan, which is a lot of presentations we saw today, for planning. And that planning cannot be done unless you understand your emissions profile. The one important thing about this chart is when you're a non-attainment, you are what we call in a capped environment. You can't increase emissions. That makes sense, right? If you're a non-attainment area, essentially what that means is you cannot increase emissions. It's capped, right? So in a capped environment, how do you grow? How have we grown in 25 years in Houston in a capped environment? You have no choice but to reduce emissions in order to grow. That's how you grow. And that's the secret to that success. Because if you're capped, you cannot increase those emissions. And if you don't increase those emissions, you cannot grow. And I'm talking about small businesses, medium businesses, large businesses, population, cars. cannot grow because you cannot increase emissions. So the only way to go is to increase emissions in order to grow. Okay, that's what we've been able to do. Just an example. I have 3 pages of this. I'm not going to bore you with it. I want to give you 1 page as an example of the kinds of programs and rules that have been implemented. Billions of dollars have been spent in the last 25 years on implementation of these programs. 80% NOx rule, that's why you saw the slide of the reduction in NOx emissions. We have put an 80% reduction NOx rule in place. Here's the HRVOC, highly reactive VOC rule that went in place in 2005. Again, we were pointing at the industry, we were pointing at ourselves, we put that rule in place. Voluntary use of IR cameras, these are called infrared cameras. These are cameras that you actually look at and you can see emissions, right? Well, there's no rule for this. We use this voluntarily in each scenario. All right, business coalition. So I'm part of a business coalition, and we call ourselves the 8-Hour Ozone SIP Coalition. SIP is standard implementation plan. Members currently varies from time to time, year to year, but right now we have 8 basically manufacturing energy companies that belong to the 8-Hour Ozone SIP Coalition. All of us have business in the Houston Galveston Missouri area. Our mission, and this is very, very important, assures that policy decisions are based upon the best scientific data. We like to use science. I've told you in an example in the HRVOC, that's where the science pointed, that's where we went, even though it pointed at ourselves. And you gotta go where the science leads you. You gotta do the work. You gotta collect the data. And results in rules that are balanced and effective. And this goes to the statement that I made earlier about the balance between economic growth and air quality. Got to have that balance. Okay? You cannot be unbalanced in one or the other. Or you should not be, I should say. Balanced and effective in achieving continued air quality improvement and a strong economy. This is what I've been harping on throughout this presentation. The kind of projects we've done over 35 science projects in conjunction with the state agency, in conjunction with EPA. We are very transparent. We post these things. We share the data with everybody. And the idea there is we've been doing this for 25 to 30 years. If there's anything to learn for another area, don't make the mistakes again. And if you can learn from the work that we've done, by all means do so and implement the things that work and don't implement the things that don't work. Okay, bottom line takeaway. Okay, after all the numbers, the graphs, and all of that, well, what's the bottom line here? Back to what I've been saying a bunch of times, John. You can achieve both. You can have air quality, and you can have a good economy. And I would argue you have to have that in an area in order to grow. Truly understand the cause of high ozone in the area, and that's where that science part comes from that I talked about. Got to understand that, and you saw some of that from Diane from the San Antonio area. And it takes a partnership to do that. You cannot do that by yourself. You gotta have the scientists, you gotta have the industry, you gotta have the state agencies, you gotta have the EPA, and you gotta have the public. It's got to be a partnership to get this accomplished. Data is your friend. A lot of people are scared of data. I don't know why, man. But data is your friend, we found over 30 years. You saw all the data that I showed you up there. We can't make the planning improvements. We cannot plan unless you have the data, okay? You have to have the data. And the last 2 points I'll make, one's on the slide, one's not on the slide. Use all the tools available to you. Don't get tunnel visioned. There are plenty of tools available to you in order to accomplish this. We saw some of the presentations today of some of those tools. There's modeling, there's monitoring, there's something called exceptional events and international emissions. And this part's really interesting because California has done a ton of work on international emissions. And what they're showing is, this is remarkable to me, the California work is showing, and it depends on which study you look at, 10 to 20 parts per billion coming over the Pacific Ocean from China. Now think about that. If you're an area, and like San Antonio, and if you're currently at 73 parts per billion, which San Antonio is, and if you find out that 10 to 20 parts per billion of that is coming over from across the ocean, and you got nothing you can do about that, you probably want to know about that. You probably want to do the science about that. You probably want to account for that, and you probably want to convince the regulatory agencies of that. That's what California is doing. So again, another good example of the kind of work that's ongoing. And then the last point, and I mentioned this earlier, it's not on the slide, but I'll say it again. In a capped environment where no emissions growth, and this doesn't matter if you get designated or not designated. If you don't want to grow emissions, and you're in a capped environment, the only way to grow is to reduce emissions. And you have to do that smartly, and you have to do that with relationships and partnerships. Otherwise, it's not going to work. Trust me, we've been doing this for 30 years in Houston. Okay? Thank you very much.
Trip down here and planning this wonderful presentation during the hurricane. So I want to point out that the centerpieces are provided by the City of San Antonio Sustainability Department, and they are seeds. So take those bookmarks that are centerpieces and plant them. I want to conclude by two things. I want to show you a chart that I was given by the we need one more chart, right? I asked the San Antonio Sustainability Department, you know, how do we compare to the Texas markets? If you overlay Austin, San Antonio, and Dallas, and Houston, you know, how have we been trending against them? We're all competing for talent and businesses that want to move here, and I think it's important that we look where we are. Who's the only one underneath that bar at the very you can see the different bars over the time. That black bar right there is the current standard. So Austin's the only one. So we are competing with Austin for jobs, talent, and businesses. It's important. It's standard of living. And we don't need to just bus people from Austin here. We need them to live here, work here, play here, from all over the world, all over the country. So. Air quality is important to millennials, and so we need to be proactive rather than reactive. As we talked about the pledge, so the Business Journal, I tweeted out me taking the pledge. Not one business responded. So we need, obviously, we don't need to wait for standards to be put on us. We need to be proactive. The business community needs to do that now rather than wait until. It takes too long to make a difference. When I moved here 4 years ago, I heard a lot about plastic bag ban and how important that was to the business community. That, you know, we moved on. The business community, when they're behind something, things happen. The bond just passed. The business got behind the bond. They got behind the bathroom bill. That was a big recent initiative. We need the business community to get behind us. So I ask, we can check 8 on here. It's things that we already do. So if you're a business here, we're going to get, everyone loves a selfie with Ron Nirenberg, right? You see them all over social media. So we're going to take a picture of the businesses that take the pledge. Huge. One box or not. We're going to do it on stage and that's the last thing we've got. So I want to thank everyone for joining us. If you did take a pledge, please be at some stage. Thank you.